Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us. I am Lauren Roberts, Director of Agency Consulting, and I'm thrilled to be here today with Jenny Honigan, one of our expert agency consultants. We are excited to share today's content with you and dive into the Applied Epic Retention Report. I'll introduce myself briefly. I have worked in insurance for a very long time now, too many years to actually count, so I'm not going to try to. I also work with several of our clients on various projects, including assistance with migrations to Applied Epic, the optimization of your Epic database, along with some fun with accounting forensics and cleanup as well. No, it's not criminal forensics. It's just going to find all of the things. Of course, I lead a wonderful team of consultants, Jenny being one of them. Jenny, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself as well?
Hello. Thanks, Lauren. I'm Jenny Honigan, and I have been with Kite for 2.5 years now. Before that, I was on the agency side as well. At Kite, I also help with optimizations and just workflows, things like that. But my biggest passion is reports and data cleaning. That's the world that I came from in a previous life, data validation. So I just love that. And I love the retention report. So much fun. You guys might not think so, but I'm kind of weird that way. So hopefully you can learn a couple of things from me today.
We are the geeks when it comes to anything epic, right?
Yeah.
We'll take it. That's fine. All right. Awesome. So for those of you guys that are unfamiliar with our organization, here is a quick overview for you. Kite Technology is a managed IT service provider and agency consulting firm dedicated to supporting independent insurance agencies and other businesses nationwide. With over 30 years of experience, what truly sets us apart is our specialized expertise in the insurance industry. Like we just said, both of us came from insurance. Many of our other team members have previously worked in the insurance field as well, giving us unique insights into what agencies really need to operate efficiently and thrive in today's competitive environment. One common challenge we address is the underutilization of Applied Epic. Our agency consulting team helps agencies maximize their use of Epic's features to ensure they get the most out of their investment and enhance their overall performance. Below are also some of our IT services that we provide tailored to meet the specific needs of insurance agencies like your own. If you'd like to learn more about our IT or consulting services, feel free to reach out through the Q&A panel. We would be happy to connect with you.
All right. So today, I want to go through just why are we going to measure retention, you know, just the reasons, the background. Of course, we're going to talk about the different ways to measure retention. I'm going to touch on how Epic Dashboards does retention and how Applied Analytics does retention. But we're going to spend the bulk of our time in the retention report in Epic. So everybody has access to that. When we go to that retention report, we're going to look through, we're going to talk about some workflow considerations. We'll go through the criteria, and then we'll spend a lot of time in the layout. So the layout gets a little tricky sometimes. And then anything else you guys want to cover or ask questions about, we'll get right on to that. So with that, I'm just going to hop right in. Why measure retention? And simply put, it just takes more resources to attract new clients than it does to keep the ones you already have. Don't quote me on this, but I believe I've read that it takes somewhere between 5 and 7 times the amount of money to bring in new clients just with marketing and, you know, all of the overhead that you have. So if you can keep the ones that you have and then just round those out or upsell to them, then you're going to do better and keep your costs down there. So now measuring retention. The traditional way of measuring retention is you take a time period and then you have your number of clients at the beginning of a time period, and you want to see how many of those are kept at the end of that time period. So if it's for a rolling 12 calendar year, you would look back from September or November of last year through today and see which ones of those clients were active at the beginning of that 12-month period, and how many are still active today. So the formula is, and this is just all across industries, your client count on the last day, subtract your new clients, and that'll be everybody that you have kept. And then you divide that by the client count on your first day of that term or that period. And then to get a percentage, you can multiply it by 100. So that's traditionally what we're looking at. So for example, if you have 150 clients at the end of the period and 25 were new, then you've kept 125 old clients. And if you had 125 that you've kept, but at the beginning of the period, you had 175 clients, then your retention rate times 100 is 71.42. And a lot of people ask, the industry average for insurance is about 84% at the client level. So that's traditionally how you measure it. When you're measuring retention at the client level, you have to remember a few things. It only counts as a loss when the last policy cancels or non-renew, so it doesn't measure the premium as it happens, the premium loss as it happens. And so you might have a bleed that you don't know that you're having if you're only measuring it at the client level when they're finally gone and out the door. So another way to measure, which we'll go into, is to measure it by policy count, premium, and revenue loss. That way you can maybe get a handle on it beforehand. And also the thing about measuring retention at the client level is you've got to have excellent maintenance of your accounts in Epic. And really you just, if your data is not clean in Epic, then your reports are never going to be right anyway, but you really do need to keep your accounts in tip-top shape. And the unfortunate thing of measuring at the client level, you can't do this from Epic reports, just one report. So you've got to be able to rely on your are you inactivating accounts, or you know, when they're out the door, that kind of thing. Are you keeping them in the correct insured and prospect types? You can use that condition of policies extra criteria on the client list, which I love, but there's just so many challenges with it. And then when you can't do it in one report in Epic, because you've got to, you have to run a list of clients. And the way I used to do is I would run a list of clients at the beginning of the term or the period, run a list at the end, and then do a VLOOKUP to see who I've lost. Just because if you can't rely on your data, you might need to do some comparisons. It was very cumbersome, to do it when I was doing it, at the agency level.
What's our favorite saying, Jenny? Garbage in,
garbage in, garbage out. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I think everybody knows that. Everybody has felt that before. I don't know if they know the phrase, but they definitely feel that for sure. Mm-hmm. So the Epic dashboards are starting to be turned on a little bit more, like slowly. You may or may not have access to them yet, but out of the clients that I'm in and out, like probably about half have access and half don't. So they're slowly turning those on. But if you go to the Epic dashboards, and I'm sorry, I don't have a live view of it, but I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on it anyway. When you first go, like from the principal owner dashboard, you'll have access to the Pulse dashboard. And when you drill down in the Pulse dashboard, you have the agency health dashboard. So the thing about this measuring retention here is that you can only select one month. So it's the retention over the month. So I looked at one this morning, and the retention was like over 100%. Just because of the way that it's calculating and things like that. So you have to keep in mind Epic dashboards, applied analytics, and the retention report are all measuring different ways. And this is what I hear a lot as well, is that, you know, people, clients want to give up on the dashboards or on analytics because they feel like the numbers just aren't right and they don't match up. Well, they don't match up because they're measuring different things. So Epic dashboards, you only select the month, Oh, I see your question, Colleen. She's asking, are Epic dashboards part of an update and will be included in current licenses? Oh, you're answering it live. Yeah, you do have to have an analytics license for that, don't you? That's right. So not everybody's getting it. Yeah. I forgot that part. Right when you asked, I forgot. Oh, yeah, you do have to have an analytics license.
They may have made a change to that because I think I had somebody the other day say that they decided not to do analytics and just are switching over to the dashboard. So really good question. I highly recommend that you reach out to your account manager with Apply, and they should be able to answer that question for you because there's a lot of moving parts since the dashboards have come out.
So the difference between the dashboards and analytics or the retention report is that you only get that 1 month range. In all cases, you can choose between estimated, annualized, and billed, and between commission or premium. But the nice this the unique thing about the dashboards is that it will break it down by branch, department, which you can do in the report, but also the NAICS code or the SIC code. So that's already built in just on the dashboards. You can see it, which I think is interesting. So this is how they define retained or not retained on dashboards. Retained is it's in force on the last day and it has at least one previous term. Not retained is it's not in force and there's no future term, so there's no renewal basically. It's not taking into account policy status at all, and it's gonna ignore anything that's in process. So if Epic sees something in process, it thinks that it's a quote and was never an in force policy. So it's basically just looking to see if this policy has been renewed or not.
And Jenny, we have a quick note from Jonathan. He says he is showing an option for the period selector in the dashboards to do a year to date instead of just the 1 month range that you mentioned previously.
Oh, interesting. I wonder if there are
Again,
different.
there are constant updates to these things, and it's
I
nearly
just checked
impossible.
it this morning in the one that I have access to, and it didn't have it. So maybe you can count me as corrected there. Just look and see in your dashboard if you have that. Oh, service summary row is SSR service summary row. So when you're on your policy screen, down below the service summary row. And so the formula that they're using is they're taking the retained divided by retained and not retained times 100. So everything that you've kept divided by everything you've kept and lost. And they're multiplying it by 100. So that's your formula. And when it's looking at the retained policies, it's looking back to the prior term, not that renewed term, because it's trying to match the terms up, for commission and premium and that kind of thing. So it's trying to keep the same time period in there. So just keep that in mind. Whenever you're in dashboards, if you hover, and the same thing in Applied Analytics, if you hover, it'll explain exactly how it's calculating it for you. So this one's just looking at whether or not we've renewed the service summary row. The agency health dashboard, is that a duplicate? Yeah, I think that's a duplicate. All right. So in analytics, you've got a retention summary. And on the retention summary screen, you can look at the client. You can do a client count. As far as I could tell on the dashboards, I didn't see a client count. It was just by policy and premium and revenue. But on the retention summary, you can see the client count. You can select last month, last quarter, year to date, rolling 12, or custom. And it compares that this period that you're looking at to the prior period. So if you're looking at a rolling 12, it'll look at the previous rolling 12 too and do a comparison right there. And then just under that, it'll do like the revenue ranking by client. So it'll have the retained clients and then your top revenue and then their lost clients there. So it's kind of nice. And then how it measures this is it says clients with policies that are not new or lost. So and it's dividing by all the clients that have policies and subtracting the new clients. So this is at client retention. So this is actually closer to that original formula that I gave you, times 100. And then for the policies, premium and revenue retention, it's taking renewed policies, dividing it by all issued policies for that time period and multiplying by 100. So if you're leaving your policies in process or submitted, it's not going to count those as an actual client. And then the definition of a renewed policy is based on the status of renewed. And you can actually, you know, I know the question was going to be, well, what about rewrite? That's a renewed status. You can actually map that to be renewed in data analytics. And so basically whatever you have mapped to be renewed, that's what it's going to count as renewed. All right, let's dig into the retention report itself. I was just trying to give you a high level overview of the other two, but in the retention report itself, and this is everybody has access, it's in the reports and marketing section of Epic, and it's going to give you, its formula is going to be total policies minus lost policies, and the lost policies are defined by the status, the canceled status, and it's going to divide it by the total policy. So it's going to take away everything that you've got, take away anything that you've lost, divide it by everything that you had to begin with, and multiply it by 100. And so in this case, if you had 3,000 policies and you've lost 500, you have 2,500 retained policies divided by that original 3,000, you get an 83.3% policy retention rate. This does take into account the status code, and in the report itself, it only builds in and accounts for the CAN, the CIR, and the CNP status.
Oh, that's a good question.
What's the question on the
actually,
report? Are there lost?
I was going to say I could actually answer that one.
Well, go ahead.
So, on the Epic report, it's defined by the policy canceled status, not the service summary row status, correct?
That's right.
Yes.
That's right. That's right. And that's what I'm going to spend a lot of my time, a lot of the rest of the time, is showing you how to account for those customized cancellation statuses that you've had, that you have. The report that we're going to run, and I'm going to hop over to Epic in a minute and I'll show you, but it's called retention report. I think it's multi-layouts. It's one of the new, we'll keep calling it new, but it's like 3 or 4 years old now, the report pack. If you don't have those reports that have the stars behind them, make sure that you call applied and get it. They can load it in like just that same day. And there's a lot of really cool layouts in there. So for this built-in retention report, you want to consider like your policy statuses, your policy status configuration. You want to be able to separate active policies from lost business, from quotes, from junk. So we always like quoting statuses. We stick with usually like a new one, a new business quote for new business, and a remarketing status or marketing status for renewals that we're quoting on. Our active policy statuses, we recommend our new, renew, and rewrite. And then we'll throw in a one-time policy status too for those policies that are like special events that that you know are not going to renew. It's a nice versatile status that keeps these policies off the missed expiration report and things like that. And you can decide how you're gonna count that as lost or not. And then junk, you know, you have all that cleanup to do and you can't delete a policy once it's been submitted or issued. The newer databases have the ECU policy status in there that you can use that to eliminate that those policies that never happened and, you know, that kind of thing.
And Jenny, based on that statement, we have a question from Madeline. She says they're doing a massive cleanup of old policies that were never taken out of submission. Is that where they would need to use something like the ECU policy status so that they don't skew retention for the year?
Yeah, I never like to go way back into history, but if you're wanting retention for the past year and you have a lot of things that you know just didn't happen, then I would use the ECU and then exclude it from the retention report criteria.
And you can also use like a quote not taken, right? And
Yes.
if it was something that was, you know, a submission that was never issued, you definitely want to not issue that policy or cancel that policy flat, and then make sure that you put it in that ECU or maybe a quote not taken status, just depending on how you want to classify that.
Yep.
Good
Yep.
question.
Absolutely. Yeah, those are good questions. One note, one bullet point I wanted to put in here was if you have a non-renewal and you rewrite it to a new carrier, you don't want to keep that expiring policy in non-renewal status. You want to change that to canceled, rewritten. I know it was non-renewed, but it was rewritten, and we're going to count non-renewals as lost business. So let's I feel like the best practice is to mark that as rewritten, regardless of the reason that it was rewritten.
And Jenny, in that situation, could they use multiple policy statuses? So could you have a canceled, non-renewed, rewritten, or
You
canceled,
could. Yeah.
marketed, rewritten?
Yeah, for your canceled status. And this is my next bullet point here. Cancel general really gives you no information. And the whole point, not the whole point, but one benefit of a retention report and also a lost business report is to see what you can control and what you can't control. So, I always say, consider adding a canceled because the client is deceased or they've sold their property or they've sold their business. During COVID, the agency that I was at, we had a lot of went out of business because of COVID kind of thing. We wanted to be able to track that. If they retired, just things like things that are out of your control. And you want to be able to sort that out from what you can control. Did you have somebody that was do you have a staff member that was rude to a client, or was it the price? Maybe you can't control the price, but I always say when it comes to canceled statuses, you don't want to overwhelm people, but you do want to be specific enough, and you want your status description to be specific enough that there's no question, is it insured's request or is it non-pay? Some people just don't pay their policy and because they don't want to renew it, and then it gets coded as canceled for non-pay. Is it because they're a bad payer or they just didn't want the policy? I don't know. I know sometimes it's kind of hard to track the exact reason.
In the report, in the retention report itself, I know it is a policy-based report. So service summary row is definitely a field that is available. So we have a question from Danielle, and they're putting in specific service summary row descriptions. However, for the purpose of this report, policy status is really what's going to drive the data of the retention. That's correct. Okay, so there's your answer, Danielle. You got to have those good policy statuses because policy statuses can be the best thing or the worst thing to happen to your book of business ever.
I always say policy status is, I mean, aside from the actual data of premium and commission, things like that, the status is probably the most important piece of data for running a report. And it can make
Absolutely.
or break your report for sure. You can pull in the description if you wanted. You could put it on your layout, but it's not going to tally that description in the way that the policy status is going to do that.
Absolutely.
Some other thing to consider is your cancellation workflow. If you're canceling a policy midterm, make sure that you cancel the current term, the one that's canceling. And then if it's close enough to renewal that the carrier's already sent a renewal for it, don't cancel the renewal because that's going to show us two policies lost instead of just one. If you're canceling it before the expiration date, and the carrier sends a renewal, make that renewal an error, not issue. You can't not issue if it downloads, but you want to make it that it never happened. So you want to error that out and put a note on there. If you're canceling at renewal, make sure that you renew that policy first and then take the cancel or do the cancel or not issue on the renewal term. If you cancel that expiring term, so I've got an auto policy that has been, you know, in force for 6 months and I cancel that one, it's going to show as if it were canceled that whole 6 months instead of canceling at renewal. And if that had been new business, then I've lost my ability to report on new business. So I always say renew that term and then either not issue it or actions cancel and issue the cancellation with a flat canceled date where your expiration date matches your effective date. Keep that expiring term listed as an in-force policy with a valid status. The question has arisen in some of my discussions that shows that you had two policies when you really only had one, but you did retain that original term. You just lost the renewal. So if you think about it that way, that's something that I always recommend. And you never want to have a cancellation status on both the expiring term and the renewal, because like I said, it'll show you as losing two policies instead of the one. So the retention report you asked earlier, it's called Retention Report Multi-Layouts with a Star, and it's part of the new report pack. Like I mentioned, it's only configured for canceled general, canceled insurer's request, canceled non-payment. So we'll need to add in any lost business for non-renewal or any specialized cancellation statuses. And canceled rewritten is not going to be considered lost business. And so we're not going to calculate it as such.
I think what I like about the retention report, so I'm going to throw my little tidbit out there, is that I can save that. You know what I mean? I'm sure there's ways that you can save the dashboards and the analytics stuff too, but like I could just have that sent to me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Month, that's a month end report. Boom, there you're done. You know, there you go. Got that historical data.
I was always taught to measure it at the client level, and I see that and I like that, but I definitely like seeing the policy level just to see where the bleeding is. All right, I'm going to hop into Epic. Yeah, the report, Sandy, the report needs to be simple enough that the owner can run without a lot of fuss and work. Yeah, definitely. And the drama is setting it up the first time. And then once you set it up, then you can set it and forget it. But it's a beast for sure. So you've got retention report multi-layouts. It's in the policy section of your reports. So you just always best practice, copy it to your My Reports, which I've done, and I've opened it up and I've set the criteria to give us a little bit more time to work on the layout. I have not fixed the layout on this version yet. So what you want to do is you just want to keep everything all, and you want to look at everything that has expired over whatever period that you're looking at. I like to keep my retention over a year just because policies are typically a year long. And I want to see what I've retained from, you know, from 1 year to the next. This was a leap year, so that's why I put in that extra day. So I've got October 18th of last year through today. And then if I set this and forget it, then every time it runs, it's going to advance because I'm using this relative date range where it reads the system date down on your computer and knows what date it is. So that's the first criteria that I select. For my status, I do want to see all of my canceled, all of my non-renews. I want to see all of this. I include reinstatement. If you see reinstatement in your data, always change that back to new, renewed, or rewrite. Because if you don't, then you've lost your ability to report on new business. If that were a new policy that was canceled and then reinstated, then you want to be able to report on that. So good rule of thumb is to look at the first service summary row and see if that action, the service summary row's action, is new or renewed to let you know. But if it's your policy, that's a cleaning report that I set up, is I look for reinstatement. Also sync, I look for those as well. And if your download is updating endorsements to PCH, you want to get those cleaned out as well.
Jenny, I was also going to ask a question, maybe Others might ask. So I see that you have client type both, and I see we also have account status both and prospective contracted being both. Can you explain why those are your criteria or if they need to be changed?
I don't like to over filter my my criteria. I know that a lot of times they come, the client type comes as just insured, but if I've issued a policy, it's going to ask me if it's going to ask me if I want to change it to insured, and you're going to say yes, and then the you know, the insured or prospect, the active and inactive, you can't inactivate a client if there's an active policy on there. So I don't need that filter. And I found that a lot of times with Epic reports, if you overfilter, it causes them to crash. Avoid the PCH code for endorsements. No, I would include that.
And I was going to do that, you know, for Cole's question, as far as the PCH code being a policy status on an active policy, it's going to be the same thing as it is with the reinstatement. Your policy needs to show what the actual policy status is. PCH should only sneak in basically through a quirk with download. Technically, you should not have any policies that are active and enforced in that PCH status, because that doesn't tell you, is that new business? Is that renewal business? Was this a rewrite? How in the world am I supposed to pay commission or expect commission on something that's a PCH? So that's kind of the whys behind just not having that as a policy status on an active policy. So if you see that, make sure you're auditing that data to make sure that you're changing that back to, like Jenny said, new renewal or rewrite or whatever your active policy status is.
I like to run just a, just set up a book of business report and look for a reinstatement PCH. SYN is another one that comes through. I like to run those just weekly, just send them out to the, sort it by account manager, send it out to them, many hands make light work, and let them clean, you know, clean that up, and just keep the data clean that way. I am an over reporter. I will send reports to people all day long. So this is basically the criteria that I pick is just, you know, policies that have expired the last year, and then all of these active statuses. Unless you're in Canada, you shouldn't have anything in policy lapse. But if you feel like maybe your people are using it, first of all, inactivate that status, those statuses, unless you're in Canada, and then you can include them if you feel like they've used them in the past. But what I'm excluding mostly is this entered in error cleanup. Those are policies that never happened. And then quotes is what I'm basically excluding, the quote not taken. And then all of these should be set for you. I want to see each time found, because I want to see every policy. I don't want to just see one per account. We could do once per policy in case there's a package there. And then you always want to include your parameter page in every report, because if it crashes and you have to call applied support, that's the first thing they're going to ask for. Crystal is asking about the status getting changed to PCH or SYN. That is in your interface configuration. And you can actually tell it not to update the policy status. If your policy statuses are being updated to PCH or SYN, it's because your configuration is telling it to update it, to update this policy status.
And that also happens in an initial load. So if for some reason you had to have an initial load of the data coming from download because of a migration or a book of business purchase or something like that, you do need to go in and audit those policies and find out what is the proper status and make sure that you change those. So it could actually be one of two situations there. And I have seen them sneak through, even when you know, set the status not to update, just depending on how the download's going. Thank you, Danielle. You're hired. So sometimes it does sneak through. So you may also want to review what your workflows are if you're seeing those sneak through. If your staff is properly starting a workflow in Epic first, then they will. You shouldn't see those statuses update at all. As long as there's a service summary row for that policy change to tie to, nothing should be, you know, updating by that status. So big answer. Sorry.
Let's look at the layouts. If you look, you'll see that it comes with a detail and a summary by producer, PPE, and branch. Sometimes you might want to see it by account manager. You can certainly copy a layout, but I would do that after after you adjust the formulas on one. I usually update just the detail, one detail and one summary, then delete the rest of them, and then just recreate the PPE and branch or however, whatever major sort that I want to see. But I want to show you what the report looks like. Here is the detail version. So this is going to be your detail of just your policies that have expired by producer. We've got this first producer, there was no PRBR, shame on us, because that's another cleaning report that you need to be running. But you will see that I have all of these policies. It lists my status. It tells me my total estimated premium. Anything that's lost, you see I don't have anything canceled. And so what it does is it subtracts this number from this number and gives me this number, and then it divides this number by this original number. Also over here in this section, it'll tally how many of each reason that I have. So I have canceled insured request, canceled non-pay. Your preview will take a long time if you have a lot of policies. This is our demo database, so we don't have a lot of policies. So now, that's one producer. Here's another. I'm hoping to find one that has an actual canceled one, but we might not find one in here. But you see it's tallying the zeros, and it's only taking into account those statuses. And this is fresh data. We got a new database, so I don't think there's anything canceled in here. Nope, I don't have anything. I don't have any lost policies in here. But at the very end, it'll give you the total for the whole agency and give you your retention percent. And then on the summary layout, it just basically takes those numbers and puts it more in a chart form. So here's all of my producers, and here's my grand totals for the agency as well. And then I've got my underlying math here. You want to go over the lines, the statuses. I'm basically doing everything except a quoting status, an error, entered an error status, and a quote not taken status. So you want everything in there that was a valid policy. So I'm putting everything in here. I'm going to open up this detail because I want to show you all the formulas. So when you open the layout, you're going to see this section here. And you've got the underlying math. And if you notice, this section is going to tally up all of the cancellations. So the CAN from this detail section up here, it's going to count them up. It's going to count the number of policies and the estimated premium for those policies. That's all in this line here. It's going to do it for CAN, CIR, and CNP. And then these numbers are actually going to feed into this section over here. So if you see the total estimated premium, that's going to be the total just of every policy right here, the total. And then here's the total of the lost estimated premium. And right now that's counting up the lost premium, this, and this field. And so that's how that's getting that. Then this is calculating this total minus the lost to give us what we've retained. And then this final formula is going to take this number that we've retained and divide it by the estimated premium. So that formula's got that. And then it does the same thing down here, but just with policy count. So don't let it confuse you. Here, the premium is on the top row, but over here, the premium is on the bottom row. So just keep that in mind. So what we're going to do is we need to add our other cancellation code. So we have CAN, CIR, CNP. We want to add non-renewal. We want to add canceled deceased or canceled sold business or what other cancellation code you have. You don't want to include canceled rewritten because that's not lost business. So just keep that in mind. That just kind of is our jumping off point. So here, these fields are actually protected by this rectangle, and the rectangle is, it's transparent, but it's there. It's kind of sitting on top of those, formulas so that you can't mess with them. And I think it's supposed to make it look pretty too. It does look kind of nice in the report. So we need to get that out of the way first. So I'm literally just going to drag it over here just anywhere. And you can resize it if you want, and just so that you know it's there. And the other thing I like to do is I like to take these column or these definitions over here. I like to keep them on the report if I'm not as familiar with it, but you can resize it. It's just a label. So, I mean, you can just type in it and it's not actual data. So that's fine. So now I've got this nice little area to work with, and I'm just going to click and drag a little rectangle to highlight those policies. No sense in reinventing the wheel. I'm going to control C to copy them. And then I'm going to go control V to paste them, and then just put them back over in the area. And you can line them up using your stuff at the top if you want. It looks pretty lined up to me. So now let's just do for simplicity's sake, we'll just do like a non-renewal. And in this case, we're going to highlight this. And right now, this is defining, if you go down here into the field attributes, this will tell you what it's defining. It's telling you what data it's pulling and what subtotal it is. And we copied the C and P. So right now, I just clicked. I did that kind of fast. You got these three little dots here. I'm just going to click that. It's going to pop this formula editor up. And now it's pulling CNP, but I want it to pull where the status is non-renewed. So I might say NON, and that's my status code. So you just have to know for your database what status code you're using for all of the lost business. I'm going to put in non here, and I'm going to do it there. That's counting the policy number now if I have a non in here. And then I'm going to do just the exact same thing with the estimated premium. And it's already pulling the policy estimated premium. That formula is already in there. Like I said, don't reinvent the wheel. And we're just going to make this non here and click OK. And then sometimes, just if you want to make it pretty, you can drag your columns out just to line it up a little bit better. And then I throw my little rectangle back over and just drag it back out. But before you do that, ooh, almost forgot this part. The totals that we're going to update, the grand total, we don't need to deal with. This is just going to subtract this from this. So we don't need to deal with that. And this is just doing the calculation of this number divided by this number. So we don't have to mess with any of those totals or those formulas. What we want to change is this. It's the summarizing of the lost business. So right now, if this is telling you that the sum is total 6, total 7, and total 8. And if I hover, you'll see that hop over. So all of these fields have a name to them. So this is, we're in premium. So we're going to the bottom, 6, 7, and 8. And if I highlight this, this is 8. This one's 7. This one's 6. And so we just want to add into that total 5. This one's called total 5. So we're just going to add a total 5 in here. I'm going to highlight this formula, and then come down here to the script. And I'm literally just going to look for total 5, not formula, but total. And there it is. And I'm just going to shove it on the end. It doesn't have to be in numerical order. I'm going to double click to get it in there. Just make sure your brackets are going all around the right places. You want to sum parentheses open, and then there's brackets around the field name with a comma in between each one, and then parentheses at the end. It's just like algebra in school. I know you loved that. So we'll click finish. And now that's going to update that total. And then we want to do the same thing for this one, for our policy count. So our policy counts are 1, 2, and 3. And then here's our policy count here. Policy. This is number 1. This is number 2. This is number 3. And we're just going to add on total number 4. If you see down here in the attributes, that's total number 4. So we're going to put that down here and go back down to our script, and total, we'll add a little comma to separate it. And total four, double click. Make sure your brackets and your commas are in between and you're good. And we'll click finish. And now that I've clicked in here, I was able to click in here and get my names. Now I can put my rectangle back. You can take the rectangle out if you don't want it in there. Sometimes I move this retention percent back over where it was. It just depends on how many codes you're going to add. I've seen tons of client codes before, or cancellation codes. So, you know, you might have them spread across the whole thing, who knows, but I like to throw it back in there, just kind of over here, and we'll just resize it and then get our rectangle back around it. And so you want to do it here, and then you also want to do it at the bottom for the grand total. This is the major sort. So at every break in the producer, you are going to get this, and then every break in the at the very end, you'll get the grand total. So you want to do it in both sections. So this is the detailed report. Somebody did ask on the webinar how to switch it from producer to account manager, and I just come over here down here at this major sort that you're grouping. Easiest thing to do is just, you know, instead of deleting this and then reinserting and lining everything back up, this, you just go over to your field attributes, and here's where your data field is. And this is pulling the producer broker name. I'm going to hit my three dots, and then I'm going to go over, go back and back. And when I get to my servicing roles, this first one's always empty. I don't know why. The second one you want. So here's your CSR folder. I'm going to open it and I'm going to grab the code. You could do the name, but remember the names are in alphabetical order by first name. So it depends on how you want to see it on your report. I like it by code because the codes start with the last name. It's the first three of the last name and then the first two of the first name. So I like to see the code first, and I'm going to hit double click just to get that in there. And then a little shortcut that I like to do as well is I'm going to click in this data field and click Control A to highlight all and Control C to copy. And that way I don't have to go filtering through those folders to update it up here in the header. And if there's no CSR listed, I just want to say no CSR. That's what we'll print up at the top of the section. It'll say no CSR since we change it to CSR or account manager. I can't remember what it's called in this database. Here you can change this to CSR name. Down here, this is just a label, so you can just change the text to whatever you want. It's not pulling in actual data. And then here, this is pulling in the producer broker name. This is a data field. So I'm going to come in here, and here's where I'm going to say Control A again to select and Control V to paste so that I didn't have to go back through and click the dots and do the folders. And so I want the actual name to display on the report. And so instead of code, I know that it's called name, the field is. So I'm just going to go back. And instead of having code, I'm going to type in name. And now it's going to pull in the CSR. The other thing I want to do is update my title. Since it's not by producer, it's by CSR. So there you go. You can also like change the color of the font. So if you want to break by CSR and you want it to be blue or dark red or, you know, whatever, you can change it down here as well. These are fun little ways to make your report look nice and professional. You can put your agency logo on there, that kind of thing. So just before you leave, after you have everything up to date, you want to save. So I'm going to click save. And now I'm going to click out of my report. So here's what the layout of that looks like. And we don't have in this section, we don't have any non-renewals, but that's what it would look like. And then this is the number that we've updated that would update with this non-renewal. So you can see some actual numbers here. This is the CSR. This one didn't have a CSR. These few didn't. So that's the other thing is, you know, I can't say it enough. You just want your data to be 100%. You just want to constantly be cleaning it and make sure that there's always a CSR. This one's missing some estimated premium, you know, things like that. So you always want that on there as well. So when you're in the summary layout, and this one's by producer, this is the one that lists the producers and then has all of the totals just along in a list. It's the same formulas. They're just kind of in different places. And if you notice at the bottom, our totals are invisible. So the first thing that I do is I always start with the major sort. If you click on the major sort, this is actually the footer because that's where you get subtotals. So it doesn't have the policy detail on it. And this is a little tricky, but you click on the top of the green there and you pull it down. And do you see there's some hidden fields here so that I can see what I'm working with? I just click an arrow or click a rectangle and drag them around, highlight them all. And you see the highlight is transparent and the font color is transparent. I just want to make the font color black for right now. So it's basically the same thing that we saw. Same situation. And because we're going to put this back to transparent at the end, because you don't want this to print underneath every single producer or every single CSR. I just go ahead and delete the retention percent like information there. So you're just going to do the same thing. You're just going to just drag and control C to copy, control V to paste, and do it ever how many times you want. You're going to update your cancellation code over here to non or whatever code you have. And you can do as many. You just have to account for them in your formula. We can change our label. It's just a label, but we're going to change that. And then we're going to change it in our estimated premium. And so now our formulas are just arranged differently up here. So you just have to think about what you're doing. The total policy count is not going to change. It's the total policies lost that you're wanting to update. So just again, this is total 1, 2, and 3. So you've got to look for the policy count 1, 2, and 3. There's 1, there's 2, there's 3. And we're going to add a total 4. So we're just going to highlight that formula again or highlight that field and come down here to the script and add in a comma and then total 4 and then click finish. And that's going to update that. We don't have to worry about this. And then here's your premium. So here's where your total is for your premium. So this is total 5. It's got 6, 7, and 8. And we're going to add in total 5. And then just make sure that you've got your comma in between and make sure you've got your parentheses on the outside and click finish. And then when you're done with that, if you have more than one, you just add them all, you know, add them all in. You're going to draw your rectangle around again and we're going to make this font color transparent again. And oops, it wants me to spell it out all the way. Let's see, transparency at the top, so that's good. And then we want to click on the green or click on this head, this footer, the top of this footer, the header of the footer, and drag it back up there. And then you want to do the same thing here. This is the grand total, so you'll want to go through and change this to a color that you can see and then update as well. So it's pretty much the same thing. The tricky one on this one is that that calculation is hidden down here. So you have to pull it down just to see it. All right. So that is updating the retention report. This is some of the criteria that we're talking about. This will be in that handout. And then there's your layouts. And then also just what to do next. You want to keep your data clean. Review your lost business report. Was it really lost or was it rewritten to a new carrier? Are there policies that are missing that you know have been renewed? So you want to look at your missed expiration report. You don't ever want things to just expire. You want to take action on that and give it an ending. Epic loves an ending. And then you want to do a canceled, but the status is not updated report. So I see this all the time. The service summary row action is canceled, but the status hasn't been updated. So it's showing as active business. And then run those audit reports. So that's all that I have. I'm gonna let Lauren jump back in now.
Yeah, awesome. So if you need some help with a retention report, like I would, I count on my experts. Feel free to reach out to us, and we help with lots of other reports too. Here's some of the other ways that we can help with various projects and options in your agency. This is what our team does best. And we really appreciate you guys joining us today and your time and such great questions. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Again, if you guys are interested in any of Kitech's IT or consulting services, feel free to contact us using any of the options listed here. We'd love the opportunity to learn more about your agency's needs and discuss how we can support your goals. Again, recording and PDF handout are coming. Before you go, please make sure you take a minute to complete the brief survey at the end of the session. I know it's a lot of information, which again is why we record, but we really greatly appreciate your feedback, and we really appreciate you guys joining us today. We will see you again next time. Have a good afternoon.